We have a great, great lineup for you today. Bring your passion to the table, and if there was somebody who's going to do that for us right now, it will be my good friend and fellow Grecian, Minas. Why don't you come up and take on the show? Thank you, folks.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me. So a little bit of a background. I started my career 10 years ago at Yale, where I did a lot of research on robot grasping, dexterous manipulation, working with adaptive, under-actuated robot hands and grippers with Aaron Dollar. After that, I left the US after 2.5 years at Yale, and I went to New Zealand, where I started the New Dexterity Research Group. And why I call it New Dexterity? Because this is what I want to bring to robotics. I want to contribute to a new dexterity in robotics. And here you see a group photo with my students and a humanoid that we have developed in Auckland, New Zealand. And I have participated in the past in many competitions, open source hackathons and things like that, developing prosthetic devices. So I'm very passionate also about the development of prosthetic devices, and I understand all the limitations that we have in replicating the human hand. And here you see a passive prosthetic device, a body-powered one. Now, today, I would like to start by taking you a little bit back, 2,500 years. And we had this very famous debate between Anaxagoras and Aristotle. So, Anaxagoras says that man is the most intelligent of the animals because he has hands. But Aristotle believes that he has hands because he is the most intelligent. So the debate here is, did the superior human brain develop the dexterity of the human hand? Or the dexterity of the human hand developed the superior brain? And what do we see here? We see a pattern, eh? We see a connection between dexterity and intelligence. And this is what I will talk about today. So, robotics, the knowledge transfer journey of robotics. I have used some pictures from my journey, but all of us in robotics, we have been very successful at publishing things in conferences, journals. We have robots in museums. And we have also started penetrating markets, but we are not there yet. A lot of markets are not penetrated by robotics. Small and medium enterprises, they don't see the benefit of robots. And of course, the holy grail, houses. How can we get there? We need a new intelligence and we need a new dexterity. Now, industrial automation, you all know how boring this situation is with robots. You have robots within cages. Logistics, warehouse automation, business as usual, eh? Pick and place, robots moving things around. And then you have a focus on very simple tasks. You have some container, you have certain packages, maybe the shapes change a little bit. You have suction grippers, parallel jaw grippers. You pick and place. The robots are in isolation, far away from humans. They don't work with us. They don't work for us. And the programming. I cannot believe that we are in 2024 and we have such slow and inefficient robot programming. You can see the face of this person. And how we teach in a more clever manner the robots how to do tasks, we may use kinesthetic teaching, canceling gravity and using gravity compensation. We may use teleoperation. And a lot of multi-billion dollar companies, they use teleoperation. And I don't understand why. If you have any convincing explanation, come and find me. Because this relies on very complicated hardware and it cannot scale up. You cannot collect a lot of data, and we need a lot of data. So, in summary, limited automation benefits, robots are in factories and warehouses where they do incredible things. But Where are they in hospitals? Where are they in construction sites, in homes, in small and medium enterprises? The hardware is ready. Not entirely, but it is ready. What we don't have the combination of dexterity and intelligence that we need in order to address the problems, in order to penetrate more markets, in order to increase the impact of automation. So robots, arguably, they need humans because humans know how to execute the tasks, right? I have skills and I need to transfer the skills from me to the robot. And they need my intelligence and expertise to adapt and learn how to execute complex tasks like dexterous manipulation within the hand in a world that has been designed for us with tools that have been designed for humans. And labor shortages. We are talking about a very significant impact that labor shortages and skill shortages will have. Worldwide, it is coming. We cannot avoid it. We need automation. Some countries will have a bigger problem than others. For example, in Europe, Germany used to be the strongest country in Europe. They start having problems because of this. And it is expected that by 2030, the worker shortage will be 85 million. This is an unbelievable market. This is an unbelievable problem, and problem equals opportunity. And the lost GDP can go up to 10 trillion US dollars. AI, you all love AI, you use AI in different companies, in different application domains. Of course, AI is here to change also robotics. You see all these headlines. I open LinkedIn every day and I read about a new announcement. It's kind of, it gives me a little bit of anxiety because every day there is a new and you think that you are not able to catch up with everything that is happening. But the truth is that AI robotics GPT moment is actually near if we have the data, because the data is the fuel that allows the models to perform efficiently. You cannot do anything without the data. And how can you get the data? A lot of people ask me, you know what, Minas, let's simulate everything. Simulation is very good at simulating locomotion. Here, I walk around and I can simulate my motion. But what happens when I interact with the environment? What happens when I manipulate the card of my room within my hand? I have friction, I have rolling, I have contact compliance, I have contact deformation. All these phenomena, and I have a card that is flexible. All these phenomena cannot be modeled. You cannot have them in simulation. So although simulation can do this, good luck transferring this to reality. You have the sim to real gap. You can do a lot of incredible things in simulation, but you cannot model complex interaction data, complex interaction phenomena. So what I want to show you today, I want to show you a new approach, the last approach, and here is how this approach compares against Pentant, kinesthetic, and teleoperation-based teaching. I compare against the three of them because they are the most realistic for deployment in everyday life environments and for the execution of complex tasks. And as you see, all the other approaches, they are not as fast, not as cost-efficient, and not as scalable. So what we need a new robot programming, data collection, and model deployment technology. And we need to have the human in the loop. And we need to have the collection of accurate robot interaction data. That's why I wear the robot in order to accomplish this. How did we solve this? Here you see the interfaces, the interface that I wear right now, that has the control interfaces here, and allows me to control a human-like hand with my fingers. You see, I move my fingers, and I am able to control all the fingers of the robot hand. I have not connected it right now because it needs a backpack that doesn't look good on stage. So, wearable intuitive interfaces. Augmented reality for model validation and refinement. So we have an augmented reality headset that allows us to project the reachable workspaces of the robot, the dexterous workspaces of the robot, the capabilities to see singularities and things like that. And we are hardware agnostic. So the idea is that these guys can interface with any kind of robot gripper, any kind of robot hand. You should be hardware agnostic. You cannot design new robots all the time. You need to be able to accommodate pneumatic grippers, electric grippers, hydraulic grippers, whatever you want. And this allows us to transfer skills from humans to robots and expertise to different end effectors, different robot arms, different robot grippers, hands. The augmented reality gives us optimization of the data collection, model testing, safety assessment, and model refinement. And of course, at the end, what we do, we facilitate robot penetration in completely new markets. And you see here how the skill gets transferred from the human to the robot. How does it work? Interfaces, we collect not only positions, we collect poses, forces, torques, and this data encapsulates the complex interactions with the objects. And then we have all this collected in the skill recording module. And we get also another system there that has the AR device in the loop that projects to us the capabilities of the robot. Then we do skill refinement, and we store all the skills in a database. And when we want to deploy, we have a task classification module that identifies what are the task requirements, and then it triggers a trajectory for the particular task that we have identified. It retrieves from the skill database the most appropriate trajectory, and then we have new desired poses, forces, and torques for the task execution. And of course, this control loop depends on the robot that you have and on the task that you want to execute. And we also collect, very, very important, we collect edge cases. For us, because we are so fast at collecting data, failures of the robot are very, very good, because we make the edge cases database bigger, 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 and we know how they fail, why they fail, how to make them better. By collecting so much data, we can even optimize robot hardware. They send us hardware, we see the limitations, and based on capability maps that we prepare offline in the high dimensional space of positions and forces, we can tell the designers what to change in their hardware. And let me show you how it works. Here we have the drill, and Gao, hello Gao, is installing the battery. And then he picks up the drill bit, and he installs the drill bit. So far it's not by manual, but after that, it becomes by manual because he needs to fasten it. Eh? And the whole operation can be very easily transferred to a robot in a matter of 1 minute. Only 1 minute. And you can do some trajectory optimization because typically human demonstrations are suboptimal. You may be shaking, or you may not be following the shortest path. And you see here the robot replicating the task as instructed by the human operator. And once you have fastened the drill bit, then you can pick up the drill and you can use the drill in order to open some holes. You can operate it. Is anybody celebrating their birthday today? Can I see hands? Nobody? Maybe this week? Tomorrow? Who is tomorrow? What's your name?
Ty.
Ty. How do you spell this? Thank you for the short name. So what will happen right now? Please, the camera, can we take the camera a little bit back from the robot? I don't want to bump the table. So what is happening here? Gao is picking up the icing bottle, and he's doing a very, very complex bimanual task. He's picking up the bottle from one side, the container from one side, and he's squeezing the container so as to write with the icing tie. Ah, and he will do it calligraphic. Nice, Gao. How you will go for the A now from there? Okay. Very, very nice. So you see, he moves a little bit slowly in order for us to make sure that we track the data with very good accuracy with the camera system that you see above the robot system. And now I need to wait for the robot to think. So I will show you another video. What we have here, we have a human testing a lamp. And it doesn't turn on. What is the problem? The problem may be that the light bulb is not completely fastened. So the human is demonstrating a fastening task where he grasps the bulb and he rotates it so as to be fully fastened. A couple of times. And then it turns on. Now, when you transfer to the robot, the sliding may be different. So you see that the lamp moves more. Or here, on the other direction, it moves much more. But we have live tracking of the lamp. And the skill can be generalized to the new position of the lamp. And we transfer the human skill, the human dexterity, the human kinematics, the human force exertion capabilities to the robot to allow it to fasten a light bulb. And our robotic chef now will try to write the name Ty. You see here how one of the grippers picks up the container of the icing. And it is a truly, truly bimanual task. You see that the T is not perfect because it didn't start ejecting the icing early, because the two containers are a little bit different. And don't forget that this is a single shot. Actually, if you want to replicate this task, you will not collect only one demonstration. You will do many demonstrations. So next time, Ty, that you will need this, we will collect many demonstrations, and your tea will be better. So where do we go from here? Now that you understand how the technology works, imagination is really the limit. We can push together robotics forward. We can collect big data of robot interactions, and we can deploy robots in everyday life environments, folding clothes, in hospitals, doing all the things that are not interesting for us, that are boring for us, that are dangerous. And I say, let's start with the dangerous. Let's start with small and medium enterprises. Let's start deploying robots in factories. After factories, warehouses, more complicated things. Let's do packaging. Let's do bimanual tasks. And together, let's push robotics towards homes. Thank you so much.